All the participants to kindly mute their mics and videos as well.
Hello, Shruba. Good morning. You are not audible. Yeah, your mic is muted.
Now
we can hear you.
My mic was moved, sorry.
So how are you? Good morning.
Good morning. The presentation can be seen or?
Yeah, it was visible.
Okay.
Yeah, but I think some other people also started presenting. So I'll request all the other participants to please stop presenting and mute their mics. We can start, Sarabjot, now?
Yes, ma'am. I'm ready.
Yeah. Yes, okay. I am not able to change my slides. So, I don't know. Like, I am presenting, but my slides are not moving. So.
Hello. Mr. Vishal, kindly stop presenting.
Yeah, I think someone else is presenting.
Mr. Vishal?
Vishal Bansal.
So, you know, I went to your presenting, but still it's not moving. So maybe I should turn off and start again.
Yeah, you can stop presenting and maybe start again.
Yeah.
In the meantime, please, other participants are requested to stop presenting and mute their mics. Yeah, I think now it is.
Yeah, now it is.
So it's okay, Shruba, now?
Yeah, I just, you know, I wanted to open the PPT file. Somehow that keynote got opened. Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah, okay.
Shall I start now?
Yeah. We are very thankful to Shubha for agreeing to speak in this time and seeing the number of participants. So you can see people are so excited to hear about the neutrinos. So I'll request Sarabjo to introduce you and then we can start with the presentation. Sarabjo?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. You whisk through the earth like water through sieve, like light through glass, no charge, no shape, and virtually void mass. Your spin is half integral, between them you tide and turn, violating charge, parity, and time. As we know, it's you, the ghost particle, the little neutrino. Khush Aamdeed. A very healthy, beautiful morning from one curious soul to all others virtually present here, thanks to the creators of Google Meet and YouTube. On the behalf of Physical Science Society at NITJ, I, Sarabjot, welcome you all to this webinar on Neutrino, the Noble Connection, by an eminent epitome of women's strength, Professor Shubhabati Goswami. She is currently Senior Professor at Physical Research Lab, Ahmedabad, India. She holds a PhD in Neutrino Physics from University of Calcutta and postdoc from PRL and Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics, Kolkata. She works on high energy physics with special focus on neutrinos. She has many awards and honors to her credit. Notably, C.V. Raman Mahila Vigyan Puraskar from SVA Karnataka 2016, Ramanujam Fellowship by DSD 2008, Humboldt Fellowship 2005, Germany, JSPS Fellowship 2002, and many more. She is a fellow of all three science academies in India and a member of India-based Neutrino Observatory Collaboration. Reverend H.O.D. Ma'am, inspiring faculty members and my fellow researchers, today is the time to feel cosmic. The universe is completely swarming with neutrinos, but we know practically nothing about them. And what we do know is really weird. Without any further delay, I urge Professor Goswami to enlighten us with her talk, Neutrino, the Noble Connection. In the meantime, I request all the participants to kindly mute their mics and videos. You may type your queries in the chat box at any time, both on Google Meet and YouTube. However, all the queries will be resolved only at the end of the talk. Thank you. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Sarabjot, for that nice introduction and also for the nice introduction to the neutrinos. In a short poem, you have said a lot of things. I would also like to thank Harleen for arranging this webinar. And a very good morning to all the listeners. And so I will start with this. So the talk title is Neutrinos, the Noble Connection. So as you can understand that what I will do is I will trace the history of development of neutrino physics and neutrino oscillation in particular through the Nobel Prizes that have been received by scientists working in this and related fields. So I myself work on neutrino, I have worked on neutrino oscillation during my PhD, which was a very exciting time for neutrino physics, and I hope to share some of these excitements with you. So the plan of the talk is this, that first I will discuss the history of the neutrino, and I will talk about the discovery of the electron and muon neutrino in some detail. Then I will come to neutrino oscillation. I will discuss the solar neutrino problem, the atmospheric neutrino anomaly, the current status of neutrino oscillation, and I will discuss some future and open issues. So the story of neutrino physics, neutrino, it's really a story of scientists who dared to dream to reach unreachable stars. So that is the we summarize neutrino physics like that, and the this impossible dream was first dreamt by Pauli in 1930 when he wrote a letter to people, and the letter said the following, that dear radioactive ladies and gentlemen, I have hit upon a desperate remedy to save the law of conservation of energy. There could exist electrically neutral particles that I wish to call neutrons, which have spin half and obey the exclusion principle. I agree that my remedy could seem incredible, but only the one who dare can win. So this was what was his daring dream. And why he had to dream this postulate, that was because in 1914, Chadwick discovered that the electron energy spectrum in nuclear beta decay is continuous. So they were observing the beta decay of BI, the nucleus BI. And what they observed was that this continuous spectrum, however, since for the electron. However, since this is a two-body decay, one expects that the electron should have a definite energy given by the difference of these two nuclei. So what happened to the, why it is having a continuous spectrum? And people speculated that whether energy conservation is violated. And to save the energy conservation principle, Pauli postulated the existence of this neutrino, which we know now is an antineutrino. So what he said is that along with the electron, a neutrino is also emitted and which is sharing the energy with the electron, and that is helping in restoring the energy conservation. So in the Pauli called it the neutron, but Enrico Fermi gave the name neutrino and the theory for beta decay. And this is denoted by this symbol nu, and neutrino means little neutral one in Italian. So to satisfy all the conservation laws of nature known at that time, neutrinos have to be massless, neutral, or very small mass, neutral, spin half, weakly interacting. So all these properties make it very difficult to detect them experimentally. And Pauli said that I have postulated something which can never be detected, and neutrinos were called the ghost particle. However, this ghost particles were detected in 1956 by Rhines and Cowans using reactor antineutrinos from the nuclear reactors. And it was discovered 25 years after it was postulated. So one can imagine how difficult it is to detect a neutrino. So the reaction was the following. They used the anti-electron neutrinos from the Hanford nuclear reactor. This was captured by the protons to produce neutrons and positrons. Now, these positrons will combine with the electrons in the medium to produce two photons. And they have added cadmium chloride in the target, and neutron will be captured by cadmium. And then it will emit a gamma to come to the ground state. And these three photons in coincidence would be a signature. And they observed this, and that was the first detection of the electron type of antineutrinos, for which Nobel Prize was given to Rhines in 1995. Clyde Cowan has unfortunately passed away in 1974, and Nobel Prize is not given posthumously. So it would be interesting to trace the history of, you know, how this experiment was thought about. So this is from the Nobel lecture of Rhines, in which is titled The Neutrino from Poltergeist to Particle. So from a ghost, how it became a particle. So what he said was, the Second World War had a great influence on the lives and careers of very many of us, for whom those were formative years. I was involved during and then subsequent to the war in the testing of nuclear bombs. And several of us wondered whether this man-made star could be used to advance our knowledge of physics. For one thing, this unusual object certainly had lots of fissions in it, and hence was a very intense neutrino source. I mulled this over somewhat, but took no action. So it seems that he has discussed this with Fermi also, and Fermi said that it's a good idea. However, later he thought that it's better to use the nuclear reactor, where the neutrinos are produced in a much more controlled environment, And he wrote to Fermi, and Fermi wrote to him, "Dear Fred, thank you for your letter of October 4th by Clyde Cowan and yourself. I was very much interested in your new plan for the detection of the neutrinos. Certainly, your new method should be much simpler to carry out, but have the great advantage that the measurement can be repeated any number of times." So he encouraged them to perform this experiment, and this is the historical telegram which they sent to Professor Pauli, and this is that we are happy to inform you that we have definitely detected neutrinos from fission fragments by observing inverse beta decay of protons. Observed cross section agrees with expected 6 × 10⁻⁴ square centimeters, Frederick Rhines and Clyde Cowan. And this experiment was sent on 15th June. I don't know if you can see the date. So, you know, this is very coincidental that this is the week in which this was discovered, and this is the week we are having this webinar. So, then what happens is that, so the Pauli's neutrino is an electron type. Now we know it's an antineutrino, so which means it is always emitted with an accompanying electron. Now the question arises that whether there are other types of neutrinos or not. Now to get into that, let us get back to a bit of history. In 1936, Anderman and Meyer discovered a particle with same charge as electron but heavier in mass while studying the cosmic rays. So this was the cosmic rays. We will come back later into it. Cosmic rays interact with the air molecule to produce charged particles, and a charged particle which was heavier than electron but same charge was found. Now at that time there was the theory of the nuclear force, that how the protons are held together in the nucleus, and that time Yukawa had predicted that there is a meson exchange, and the mass of this particle was estimated to be the same as Yukawa's meson. So initially it was thought to be Yukawa's meson responsible for nuclear force, but it was found to be too weakly interacting. It seems that in 1943, Sakata and Yuno suggested that this particle is not the Yukawa meson and proposed the decay scheme of this particle, that this particle goes to an electron and two types of neutrinos. And so they were the first to say that there exists a neutrino different from the electron type of neutrinos. However, because of Second World War, this paper was published much later in 1964. I gave this talk few weeks back, and I didn't know about this information, but Professor Sandeep Pakwasa, who is a renowned neutrino physicist in University of Hawaii, he sent me a mail giving this information. So I thought in my next talk I will put it. So I thought I will put it here. And just a second. Just a second, excuse me. Okay, so what happened was cosmic rays have at that time, during that time, had been a great, you know, source of studying fundamental particles. In 1947, Powell and his collaborators observed the decay chain. Observe the decay chain pi plus going to mu plus and mu plus goes to e plus. So what they observed was that a pion is decaying into a muon, which has a longer track and an electron, and there is some invisible neutrinos which were emitted here. So they, from the energy energy balance, they said that this is the dominant decay mode, pi plus going to mu plus mu. For this, Nobel Prize was awarded to Powell in 1950, because they developed the photographic method of studying nuclear process and his discovery of mesons by this method. So in 1960, Bruno Pontecorvo suggested that the neutrinos produced in this decay may be different from the neutrinos produced in beta decay. As I said, in 1943, Sakata and his collaborators also suggested it, but in Bruno Pontecorvo also suggested in 1960. And in 1962, this experiment was carried out using a beam of 15 GeV protons in the AGS accelerator in Brookhaven. So what they were doing was that antineutrinos from pion decay from this accelerator was hitting a proton target, and then this nu mu bar will interact with the proton to produce muons. What they observed was 29 muons, but they did not observe any electrons. So it showed that the neutrinos that are produced from the nu mu, so what it showed is that these neutrinos are different neutrinos than the electron type of neutrinos, because they are produced in association with a muon and not with an electron. So this was the first high energy neutrino experiment. And for this, Nobel Prize was awarded in 1988 to Lederman, Schwartz and Steinberger. And the Nobel citation read that for the neutrino beam method and the demonstration of the doublet structure of the leptons through the discovery of the muon neutrino. So this was the reason that they did the neutrino beam method, and they said that there are two types of leptons, like muons and its associated partner nu mu, and electrons and its associated partner nu e.
Excuse me, ma'am, sorry to interrupt, but the slide is stuck on the 14th one. We are not able to see.
Oh, maybe you can stop and then start again. Stop presenting.
Yeah, just a second. One second, I should open the slide. Just a second. Somehow it's not giving me the option of the The screen is not coming, right? Closed everything, then I opened the talk. But you know, when it shows me, it's not showing me.
Ma'am, there is a mic interference problem.
What problem? I think everyone is of the mind.
Well, there is a voice in the mic, man.
We can't hear you, Ram.
Because my microphone is off.
Ma'am, the problem is your laptop mic and your phone probably are too close to each other. So there is an interference between them. So try and make a distance between them.
Can you see?
There's a constant echo.
Can you see the presentation?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, because you know, I'll
Madam,
there must be two windows open, so they interfere with each other.
Let me put the earphone. Now it's not coming, right?
Now it's crystal clear, ma'am. No problem.
It's good now.
Yeah, but the PPT.
Yeah.
I can't see the PPT.
And there is two window from your side.
Two window?
Yes, ma'am.
So let me.
Ma'am, you can try the laptop mic, turn off, and then you can try it.
Everybody, please turn off your video. When you turn on your video, it will use more internet and will cause noises. Amardeep and Nitai, please turn off your video. Pankaj, please turn off your video.
So it's present now, a window. You must grant permission in order to share your screen. That I You know, let me connect one more time. There is some problem. Can you see now?
Yes, ma'am. Intensive.
Okay, you know, somehow it is not coming in my window, so I will just go back to my talk and from there I will tell, okay? So, in my, this window it's not coming. In my Google Meet window, it's not coming. So, I was in slide 14, right? Sorry about that, you know, but these are the new normals with which we are. So I was in slide 14. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Go on.
Yes. Okay. So I was in slide 14 and I said that in 1943, Sakata and Ainu suggested this decay, and actually this paper, because of Second World War, came in 64. So then what happened was, this was, so they said that it is not the Yukawa's meson. And then the pion was discovered in 1947 by Powell and his collaborators by observing the decay chain, that a pion is going to a muon, which is giving a long track and an electron. And the dominant decay mode was neutrino, because from the muon decay as well as the pion decay, some neutrinos were emitted. For this, Nobel Prize was awarded to Powell in 1950 for observing, for his development of the photographic method of studying nuclear processes and his discoveries regarding mesons made with this method. So after pion was discovered, then in 1960,
development of the photographic method of studying nuclear processes and his discoveries regarding mesons made with this method. So after pion was
In 1960, Bruno Pontecorvo suggested that the neutrinos produced in the decay pi plus going to pion going to mu and nu may be different from the neutrino produced in beta decay. So, you know, we started with the question that whether there are more than one type of neutrino or not. So first we knew in beta decay there is one type of neutrino, electron neutrino. After that, what we did was we said that muon was discovered in cosmic rays, then pion was also discovered in cosmic rays, and then the question arose that whether these neutrinos which are produced in association with muons are the same as the electron neutrino or they are different than the electron neutrino. This experiment was performed in 1962. By Lederman, Schwartz, and Steinberger, and what they did was that they had these antineutrinos coming from pion decay. So they didn't know what type of, supposing we don't know what type of neutrinos they are, but they will interact with the proton to produce a muon. And if they are same as the electron type of neutrinos, then they will produce the electrons, positrons. However, what happened was they observed 29 muons as opposed to zero positrons. So which showed that the neutrinos that are interacting, coming from the pion decay, are different than the electron type of neutrinos which produce electrons or positrons, and they are producing muons. So what we see is that there is a different neutrino in produced in association with the muon. This was the first high energy neutrino experiment. This was the first high energy neutrino experiment for which Nobel Nobel Prize was given to Lederman, Schwartz and Steinberger in 1988. So the Nobel citation read for the neutrino beam method and the demonstration of the doublet structure of the leptons through the discovery of the muon neutrino. And it was a crucial step to the current world view of particle physics, which we call standard model. So what it is meant by the doublet structure is that, you know, that there will be an electron neutrino in association with the electron. There will be a muon neutrino in association with the muon. So there is a some kind of a pairing. And between 1962 to 1988, high energy neutrino beams found intensive and varied applications in particle physics explanation. And we know that these accelerator neutrino beams played a great role also in development of neutrino oscillation, in precision determination of neutrino oscillation parameters. And there are ongoing experiments and upcoming experiments also in this. So, but this was first done by these people for which Nobel Prize was given in 1988. So now we know that there are three types of neutrinos. The third type of neutrino was discovered in 2000 by the donut experiment at Fermilab. So we know that there is a which is in association with the tau lepton. So we know that there is a nu e in association with the e, nu mu in association with mu, and nu tau in association with tau. Now one can always ask the question, are there more? And actually there are certain experimental evidences which says that there may be some other type of neutrino with which there can be no charged lepton, and which are called the sterile neutrinos. And you know, it's a quite active branch of physics research, both experiment, phenomenology and theory. But in this talk, we are not going to discuss it. So we are discussing about the three types of neutrinos, which are the electron neutrino, which is produced in association with electrons, the muon neutrino, which are produced in association with muons, and the tau neutrino, which are produced in association with tau. And there are many sources of neutrinos, both natural as well as lab-based. So for instance, the Big Bang, which produces the cosmic microwave background, also produced neutrinos. There are neutrinos observed from supernova explosion. Solar neutrinos have been observed. Atmospheric neutrinos observed. There are galactic and extragalactic sources which were thought that maybe like active galactic nuclei or gamma ray burst, they can give rise to neutrinos. And some of these neutrinos have been observed by the ice cube experiment. We also have sources like the reactor neutrinos and the accelerator neutrinos, which are man-made neutrinos. And all these neutrinos cover a large range of energy. The Big Bang neutrinos are very low energy. The solar neutrinos are around MeV energy. Supernova neutrinos are also in that range. Atmospheric neutrinos are in the GeV range. Then the reactor antineutrinos are in the MeV range. Then we have very high energy neutrinos. So they span a wide range of energy and allow us to study their properties using a large range of energy of neutrinos and from different sources. Now the question arises that if there are so many neutrinos coming from different sources, then why we can't see them? Now it seems that our body receives billions of neutrinos from sun and billions of neutrinos from the natural radioactivity of the earth, from the nuclear power plants all over the world. But why do we not see them? That is because they are very, very weakly interacting. So to give you an idea, it is the cross section is like 10 to the minus 38 centimeter square at 1 GeV. So it's really very, very low cross section. So how is a neutrino detected? As I said in two different experiments, that a nu e will be detected by observing the electrons, because neutrinos cannot be observed themselves. Nu mu is detected by observing the muon. So because they are very weakly interacting, the detectors have to be big so that we have enough statistics. They have to be deep so that to reduce cosmic radiation, so that you know we don't have the background neutrinos and we have the only the neutrinos that we want to detect. And the electrons and muons are not produced by the cosmic rays but from the neutrinos. And they also have to be clean, as I said, to have the radioactive, reduce the radioactive background. So this, all these things are very difficult, and even if you make a neutrino, it takes a lot of time to one has to be very patient to detect them. And if I have a very huge detector, for instance, you know, it is to the scale so much more than a human, then it will be about 300 interactions per day. I will come little later to, you know, more realistic figures of neutrino detectors. Now, then if it is so difficult to detect them, and then why are we so interested in detecting them? There are several reasons. One is we know that they are responsible for the sun to shine. They are everywhere. We have seen from so many sources they are coming, so they can allow us to study those sources. They carry information from stars because they are weakly interacting, whereas a photon will interact in the sun and then it will come. The neutrino will come without interacting, so it will come much faster. So it can carry information from a solar interior, for instance. Also, they pose interesting puzzles, and that is also another reason that we should study them to see what are the reasons for these puzzles and how, which way these can be solved. And so these puzzles are related to the property of neutrino oscillation, which is that it has been found that neutrinos can undergo change of flavor after passing through a distance. So I said that a nu mu is associated, is always produced in association with a muon. Or a muon will be giving a nu mu. Now, supposing this nu mu passes through a distance, and in a detector we get a tau, and there is no other source of neutrinos, then we can say that a nu mu has been converted to a nu tau while passing through this distance. And theoretically, it is possible if neutrinos have a mass and mixing, this is like a quantum mechanical interference phenomena, and this conversion probability is oscillatory. So this phenomena is known as neutrino oscillation. So this is a cartoon for neutrino oscillation, that although they are very weakly interacting, they mix with their friend and they change their identity during the flight, and they are confused and they change their identity. So the physics of the new, to some history, and then I will come to the physics of the neutrino oscillation. It was proposed by Pontecorvo in 1957. At that time, only one type of neutrino was known, and so he proposed that neutrino-antineutrino oscillations. But two neutrino mixing was proposed by Maki, Nakagawa and Sakata in 1962. And they, so all these four people are called the, you know, the fathers of neutrino oscillation. So Bruno Pontecorvo predicted that neutrinos associated with electrons are different from those associated with muons. For experimental verification of this, Nobel Prize was awarded to Steinberger, Lederman and Schwarz in 1988, as I said, proposed the reaction for detection of solar neutrinos in the chlorine experiment. For this, Nobel Prize was awarded to Davis in 2002, I will come to this, and proposed that the neutrinos may convert into another type of neutrinos, a phenomenon known as neutrino oscillations. For this, Nobel Prize was awarded to Takaki Kajita and Art MacDonald in 2015. So the Pontecorvo actually predicted all the ideas for which Nobel Prize in neutrino physics was awarded. So the history of neutrino oscillation, the physics of neutrino oscillation is as follows in simple terms, that when neutrinos have mass, then if I have say nu mu and nu tau, they are, then these flavor states, nu mu and nu tau, are not states of finite mass, but they are mixtures of these. So nu mu and nu tau will be mixture of the light and the heavy states. And this mixing, mixture is governed by the superposition is governed by a mixing angle theta. So then the question is that this, how does this superposition of mass states evolve in vacuum? So what happens is, as the neutrino travels, then the heavier part will fall behind and the lighter part will go ahead. So what happens is, this will give rise to a phase difference. And because of this, this proportion which makes a nu mu, nu light and nu heavy, a nu mu, will change. And what we will have is at a later time a mixture of nu mu and nu tau. So this is a basic physics of the neutrino oscillation. It's easy to calculate the oscillation probability. So what happens is, we take the mixing matrix in terms of the mixing angle theta. And neutrinos acquire different phases as they propagate, because this phase is related to the mass. And since the masses are different, the neutrinos acquire different phases. So a phase difference develop between the states, because M1 is not equal to M2. So at later time, if we start with a new E, then it will be, initially I had cos theta nu 1 plus sine theta nu 2. But at a later time, there will be this exponential minus I E1 t piece and exponential minus I E2 t piece coming because of propagation. And so this will no longer be equal to nu E at time t equal to 0. And one can calculate, it is very easy, simple quantum mechanics to calculate the survival probability in vacuum. So one gets, this is 1 minus sine square 2 theta, sine square 1.27 delta m square L by E, and this is known as flavor oscillation. The conversion probability in terms of two generation will be 1 minus this, because the total probability is, this matrix is orthogonal, or you know, more than two generation, it will be unitary. So this is the conversion probability, which is sine square 2 theta. The amplitude is governed by the mixing angle, and the phase is governed by the length traversed by the like this, and this is the oscillation wavelength, which can be expressed in terms of the energy and the mass squared difference. So we can express this in terms of pi L by lambda. And this oscillation wavelength will tell you whether the neutrinos will oscillate or not. If this oscillation wavelength is much greater than the distance traveled, then this sine square term will go to zero and there will be no oscillation, will not get time to develop. If this oscillation wavelength is much less than L, then there will be many, many oscillations. So this term will go to half. And if lambda is of the order of 2L, then this is pi by 2, and then we have maximum oscillation effect. So oscillation effect is maximum when delta m square is of the order of E by L. So, you know, when we are designing an experiment, then the energy and the length scale will tell us what kind of mass square difference for the neutrinos we can probe. So what we see is that the neutrino oscillation requires that the masses have to be zero, non-zero. The mixing angle has to be non-zero, because if this is zero, then this probability will become zero. Now, neutrino oscillation is not sensitive to the absolute mass, but it is sensitive to the mass square difference. So at least one of the mass states have to have non-zero mass for neutrino oscillation if we consider two flavors. So this is the sensitivity in various oscillation experiments. So as I said, that you know, the sensitivity to delta m square will depend on the energy and the length scale. And for instance, if we have reactor neutrinos, then they have MeV energy and distance 100 meter. So we will have 10 to the minus 2 eV squared sensitivity. So it will depend on the energy and the, you know, the distance traveled, that what kind of delta M square we can probe. For instance, solar neutrinos, and this is minded vacuum oscillation. So far we have considered neutrinos traveling only in the through the vacuum. In solar neutrinos, they are passing through 10 to the 11 meters, so they can probe 10 to the minus 10 eV squared distance. Atmospheric neutrinos, GeV energy 10,000 kilometer, so they can probe 10 to the minus 4 eV squared. So this is some order of magnitude. If the energies have a spread, then they can spray, they can, you know, probe a range of delta M squared. Now, when initially the neutrino experiments were performed, then there were not much planned, like, whatever, you know, whatever experimental setup you have, you can try to conduct a neutrino experiment and see what kind of neutrinos, what kind of mass square difference you probe. But slowly things became, that is with the, I am saying, with the man-made sources, so slowly things became more planned. I will come to that. Now, I talked about neutrino oscillation in vacuum. However, when neutrinos pass through matter, then they will interact with the matter. Now, normal matter have only electron, proton and neutron. So only the neutrinos and the antineutrinos have charge current interactions. So which is mediated by the charge W boson. If you don't know about this, then just assume that the neutrinos will interact, and the neutrinos can interact in two ways, in which a neutrino goes to an electron at the vertex. So there is a charge change, so it is called a charge current, and another is a is the neutrino goes to another neutrino in a vortex. There is no charge change, so this is called a neutral current. They are mediated by different kind of mediators. Now, having this reaction, you have to have the electrons. But nu mu and nu tau only undergo this type of reaction. And what you see is that this neutral current reaction is same for all three flavors, e mu tau. But the nu e undergoes this charge current reaction, producing an electron. And this scattering gives a effective potential in matter. And this difference in the potential give rise to an effective mass difference in matter. So the electron type neutrinos have a different mass than the muon and the tau type neutrinos in matter. This is analogous to, you know, the change in photon mass in a medium. When neutrinos travel through to in a medium, then their mass is changed. But the novel thing here is that the electron type, the mass of the electron type neutrinos is changed due to the property of the medium. So then what happens is that in vacuum, we have an effective Hamiltonian or the effective propagation equation. And we have the eigenstates nu1 and nu2, as we said. In matter, the propagation equation will change because of this effective potential. And we will have mass eigenstates in matter. We have to solve this propagation equation to find the mass eigenstates in matter and the mass eigenvalues in matter. And the mixing angle in matter, which is called theta m now, is defined in terms of these matter states, not the vacuum states. So then the this mixing angle and the masses in matter will be different. So this is the matter effect. Now, the experimental evidences for neutrino oscillation have come from solar neutrinos. The confirmation has come from reactor neutrinos. The solar neutrino oscillation have been confirmed by reactor neutrinos using laboratory sources. Then from atmospheric neutrino oscillations have been observed, and confirmation has come from accelerated neutrinos. As I mentioned about the sterile neutrinos, which were confirmed by LSNB and also Mini-Boom, but we are not going to discuss it. Now, Nobel Prize in 2002 was awarded for neutrino astronomy for observation of these neutrinos. So you can see that the observation of neutrinos is such a challenging thing that the Nobel Prize have been awarded many times for the observation of these neutrinos, from the electron antineutrinos, for the muon neutrinos, then for solar neutrinos and the supernova neutrinos. So the Nobel citation rate for pioneering contribution to astrophysics, in particular for detection of cosmic neutrinos. So the Nobel citation read like this: Raymond Davis constructed a completely new detector, a gigantic tank filled with 600 tons of fluid. So you can see the, you know, the scale of the detector size, as I said earlier, which was placed in a mine over a period of 30 years. He succeeded in capturing a total of 2000 neutrinos. So 2000 neutrinos in 30 years from the sun, and was thus able to prove that fusion provided the energy from the sun. With another gigantic react detector called Kamiokande, a group of researchers led by Koshiba was able to confirm Davis's results. They were also able on 23rd February 1987 to detect neutrinos from a distant supernova explosion. They captured 12 of total 10 to the 16 neutrinos that passed through the detector. The work of Davis and Koshiba has led to unexpected discoveries and a new intensive field of research, neutrino astronomy. So I will discuss the solar neutrinos now, for which Nobel Prize was awarded to Koshiba and Davis. So sun is a copious source of neutrinos. The nuclear fusion reactions, which produce light and heat, they also produce neutrinos. Now, and also neutrinos come before light from the sun's core, and you know, because they are very weakly interacting, they can also come during the night when the sun is on the other side. They can pass through the earth and they can come. So the solar neutrinos are produced through a chain set of chain reactions, like the PP chain. Also there is a CNO cycle. The main reaction is where four protons fuse to produce alpha particle, the positrons and the neutrinos, and also heat and light. And the solar neutrino spectrum can be calculated from by something called a standard solar model, which was developed by John Buchol. Now the shape is determined by the underlying nuclear physics, but the normalization will depend on the calculation of the standard solar model. So first detection of solar neutrinos was by the Davis's experiment, the 37 chlorine experiment. This was pioneered by John Buckle and Davis, and their main aim initially was to probe the solar interior with the neutrinos. So they say that, okay, can we verify the phenomenon? And they thought they will employ this equation where 30, you know, the Greek, this
reaction. Ma'am, presentation is not visible. Okay, no, it is.
Visible? Okay, maybe some internet problem, yes. Also, just a second.
Some other person was presenting actually.
Oh, okay. Just a second. So, my, this is running. So what they employed the reaction that the NuNi will be absorbed by 37 chlorine, producing a 37 argon and an electron. Now, this is like, you know, this is a simple reaction, but to observe this was very complicated. So what they had to do is they have put this cleaning fluid in which chlorine is there, perchloroethylene, in a huge tank. They put it exposed in the sun. So the chlorine will absorb the electron. They will extract the chlorine by chemical extraction method, and then they will extract the argon from the chlorine by chemical extraction, and they will observe the radioactive decay of the argon to count the number of neutrinos. Now, so you know, the radioactive decay has a half-life, so the neutrinos will be, the target will be exposed, the detector will be those many days, which is less than the half-life. Then the argon will be extracted, the radioactive decay of the argon will be observed, and then the number of neutrinos will be counted. So this is a quite cumbersome procedure and complicated. And what they found was only 1/3 of the predicted neutrinos were observed. First, they said in
presentation is not on the main screen. It means your video is coming on the main screen.
Okay, so I should then stop and again. Somehow it stopped. Somehow I don't know why.
Yeah, no, it is coming.
Because I was not I had not the screen opened, so I didn't do anything.
Yeah, no, it is.
Because I can't see my presentation in the screen. Okay, so
now we can.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, it is clearly visible.
Okay.
No problem, ma'am. It is clearly visible. It's okay.
Okay. So only 1/3 of the observed. So then, why the 2/3 of the neutrinos are missing? Where are they going? Now there were many speculations at that time. And the first speculation was that the experiment is wrong, because it is, you know, I told you the procedure. They said that maybe there is some mistake made in extracting this handful of argon atoms from the chlorine. And, you know, these kind of detectors were 600 ton. They were not even observing one event per day. It was really, really very less number of events. Then some people said that the solar model calculations may be wrong, because the solar model calculations also have a lot of things assumed. You know, the solar reaction rates, how the neutrinos and the other particles are being propagated in the sun, the convection in the sun. So a lot of things are there. But another explanation was like what Pontecorvo said, that the solar electron neutrinos are getting converted to some other species, like the muon or tau neutrinos or something else. And so that we cannot see the neutrinos as we are expecting. And new experiments were planned to check the above results. So one of them were the gallium experiments, and there were three collaborations, SAGE, Galax, and GNO, which observed these reactions, that neutrinos were absorbed in 71 gallium to produce germanium and electron. This was again a radiochemical technique experiment. And the importance of this is they have a lower threshold than the chlorine experiment. So they are sensitive to the PP neutrinos, which I showed you the chain. Here you can see that this is the PP neutrinos, which have a lower energy, and this is the 8 boron neutrinos, which have the higher energy. So depending on from which reaction the neutrinos are coming, they have different energy distribution. So these PP neutrinos, they have the highest flux. So they are responsible mainly for the solar luminosity, but the 8 boron neutrinos goes up to higher energy. So the PP neutrinos, these gallium experiments have a lower threshold. So they were sensitive to the PP neutrinos. So they can test the solar luminosity also. But they also observed that only half the neutrinos were coming. So they confirmed the solar neutrino shortfall observed by Davis. Now there is also the Kamiokande experiment in 1991, Kamioka neutrino nucleon decay experiment, which started in 1991, and the main aim of this experiment was to observe proton decay. There are certain theories beyond the standard model, that is the, you know, currently well established model to explain all the phenomena, that which says that the proton may decay. However, what happened was that, so they this experiment was planned to observe the proton decay. They also observed the solar neutrinos, and they observed the solar neutrinos. So the chlorine experiment, as you can see, they are exposing, say, for a n number of days, and they are the gallium, and they are extracting. So they don't know whether the neutrinos are coming from the sun or not. Definitely they cannot say. But the Kamiokande experiment employed this neutrino electron scattering reaction, so they can record the direction from which the electrons are coming, the neutrinos are coming, and so they verified that it is indeed coming from the sun, because the distribution they plotted of the direction of the neutrinos pointed towards the solar direction. This is called a real-time experiment. And then the Super Kamiokande experiment was the successor of Kamiokande, which also confirmed this with much higher statistics. So this is the status of the solar neutrino experiment. This is with pre-snow, I am saying. I will come to why I am separating them. So, and what is snow? So this is the chlorine experiment. They observed 1/3. So this is the theoretical prediction with some uncertainties. But this blue is the observation for the gallium experiment. This is the for the Kamiokande experiment. This is the observation for Kamiokande, and this is the observation from Super Kamiokande, and this is the this is from the gallium experiments. So you can see that the all the experiments are observing that the new E flux, because the from the sun the new E is coming, and this all these experiments are sensitive to the electron neutrinos. So they are observing that the electron neutrinos are coming less in number. So this was known as the solar neutrino problem, that the observed new E flux is less than theoretical prediction, and this remained unsolved for 30 years. Now this problem was solved decisively by the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory experiment in Canada. They employed a reaction in neutrinos in heavy water, which is the charge current. They have two types of reaction with the deuterium in heavy water. One is the nu E is captured by the deuterium to produce an electron. This is a charge current reaction, because at the vortex the charge will be changed, and there will be a neutral current reaction where a neutrino will be captured by the deuterium to produce another neutrino. So this is a neutral current reaction. Now supposing I have only electron type of neutrinos coming from the sun, then my CC by NC ratio should be 1, because there is this same number of nuons will coming from the charge, will interact with the deuterium. However, what they observed that, however, if the there is conversion to nu mu and nu tau, then the neutral current reaction will have nu mu and nu tau along with nu e. So the charge current by neutral current ratio should be less than 1. So they employed 1,000 tons of heavy water in it was put in 7,000 feet underground in Sudbury mine, and there were 10,000 photomultiplier tubes to record neutrino event to study this ratio, charge current by neutral current reaction. And what they observed was that this charge current by neutral current ratio is indeed less than 1, it's 0.34. So this is the charge current reaction of snow, and you can see that the for the charge current reaction, where the snow is observing only the electron type of neutrinos, there is indeed a deficit as observed by the other experiments. However, when they consider the neutral current, which is contributed by all three types of neutrinos, then it is matching the theoretical prediction. So now there is a 7 sigma evidence observed by Snow for non-zero nu mu nu tau flux from sun. So Snow established conclusively that neutrino flavor is there is favor conversion, and that is the solution of the solar neutrino problem. They also said that, you know, the 8 boron flux to which the Snow was sensitive, because it is also has a higher threshold. It is a Cherenkov detector using photomultiplier tube. So that also always has a higher threshold. That is like the super Kamiokande detector. And so they observed that the 8 boron flux as predicted by standard solar model is same as that observed. So they also confirmed that the standard solar model is correct. And they confirmed that the muon and tau neutrinos are there in the solar flux. So they confirmed that there is neutrino oscillation. So what happens is that neutrinos change themselves. That if I have an electron type of neutrino, then after while they are passing through a distance, they get mixed with each other. And when they come to the Earth, we are getting a mixture of the neutrinos. So what the Art MacDonald, who is the leader of the Snow experiment, got Nobel Prize for this, and the Nobel citation read, meanwhile, the research group in Canada led by Arthur B. MacDonald could demonstrate that the neutrinos from the sun were not disappearing on their way to Earth. Instead, they were captured with a different identity when arriving to the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory. So actually, if you really try to understand that what is the main solution of the solar neutrino problem, like, okay, we know there is solar conversion, but whether it is vacuum oscillation of the neutrinos or the matter in the solar is playing some role, then one see that it is actually the matter effect in the neutrinos, which is known as the MSW resonant flavor conversion, Mikhail Smirnov Wolfenstein. You know, it is named after the people who proposed it of the nu inside the sun. And what does it tell us about the neutrinos? Because as I told that the neutrino oscillation depends on the mass square difference of the neutrinos and the mixing angle. This is tan square theta here. Somehow this was not coming. When this data was coming, we were doing our PhD. I was doing our PhD and then I was a postdoc, and we did a lot of research on the solar neutrino data. How it evolved. So what happened was in 2001, before the Snow data came, there were many solutions to the solar neutrino problem, which is that there were many values of mixing angle and mass square difference which would fit the data. For instance, there was a solution at the low mixing angle, tan square theta around 10 to the minus 3, minus 4, like that. And there is also very low mass square, 10 to the minus 10 eV square, which is vacuum oscillation solution. And however, with the Snow data, the region was conclusively proved to be this region, which is around 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5, delta m square in the 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5 eV square. And sine squared theta around 0.3. So that was the information we got from the solar neutrino data on the mass square difference and the mixing angle. And this was confirmed by the Camland experiment using reactor neutrino. So these plots were from our paper. We did systematic analysis of this data to extract these mixing angles and the mass square differences. So there were few groups in the world who were doing, and ours was one of the groups. Now, Camland experiment is a reactor experiment. So they have energy of the neutrino of the order of 3 MeV, and they were the distance of the source detector distance was about 180 kilometer. So they would be sensitive to delta M square in the range 1.6 to 10 to the minus 5 EV square. So this is in the right ballpark of the solar neutrino problem, and they observed these oscillations. So for the solar neutrinos, what happens is we are observing the MSW conversion inside the sun. But when they are coming from sun to Earth, because the mass square difference is 10 to the minus 5 EV square, the neutrinos do not oscillate, because to oscillate the neutrino mass is needed 10 to the minus 11 EV square. So from the sun to Earth, they are not oscillating. But they, but from the Camland observes with corresponding 10 to 10 to the minus 5 EV square, they observed this oscillation cycle. And when they observe the oscillation, then they can give very precise value for the mass squared difference. So that is the thing that the Kamland confirmed the solar neutrino problem using man-made sources. Now we come to the atmospheric neutrinos. We talked about cosmic rays producing pions and muons and the neutrinos. Now, if you see this decay chain, then there are two new mu as opposed to one new e. So this is, you know, the pions are produced mu plus new mu. There can also be pi minus produce mu minus and new mu bar. So cosmic rays produce neutrinos and antineutrinos of muon and electron flavor. And this was one of the first detection was in India in Kolar gold mine. Now these have a large range of energy, 100 MeV to TeV. Path length is also large, 15 to 13,000 kilometers. So they provide a large L by E band to study the neutrinos. Now, and if you see, then you can see from this chain, then there should be two new mu with respect to one new E in these experiments. However, many of the experiments observe that this is not true. So I told about the Kamiokande experiment, which was which also observed the solar neutrinos. They observed the atmospheric neutrinos and they did not observe this ratio. Also the IMB experiment, which is a Cherenkov experiments. But there were certain experiments like Nusek and Sudan too. They said that no, this ratio is observed. So what they were giving was this mu by E data to mu by E of their theoretical prediction. And many of the experiments observed this to be less than one. So this implies new mu conversion. So the question is then what is happening to the muon neutrinos? Why are they coming less in numbers? And to test this Super Kamiokande experiment conclusively established that what is happening to the muon neutrinos. So Super Kamiokande, as I said, it was a huge detector. This is 50,000 ton of purified water, 3,000 feet underground. And they have 13,000 photomultiplier tubes, like Snow had 10,000 photomultiplier tubes. So these are, you know, such huge detectors. And they observed the atmospheric neutrinos. And they have enough statistics to study the events in zenith angle beams. And what I mean by zenith angle beams is that, you know, the neutrinos which are the atmospheric neutrinos are coming from all directions. Now they are the neutrinos which are coming from the near the detector, they are traversing 20 kilometer, and this is you know, from the zenith angle cos theta minus 1. And neutrinos which are coming from the plus 1, sorry, and the neutrinos we are coming through the earth, they are passing 10 to 10,000 kilometers, so minus 1, they are the upgoing neutrinos. So neutrinos which are coming down to the detector, it is possible that if neutrinos are oscillating, that they will not have enough distance to oscillate. However, these neutrinos can oscillate, and this can cause an up-down asymmetry. And if you see these events, this is the theoretical prediction, then more or less, there is an up-down asymmetry between the events. So if the detector observes an up-down asymmetry, then they can say that the neutrinos may be oscillating. And Super Kamiokande indeed observes the up-down oscillations. They found that these upward-going neutrinos, that is the neutrinos coming through the earth, this is the red data, they are suppressed as compared to the theoretical prediction, which is blue. This green is the new mu new tau oscillation. So this established new mu new tau oscillation as a solution to the atmospheric neutrino anomaly. So they got the Nobel Prize for this, and the Nobel citation read around the turn of the millennium. Takaki Kajita presented the neutrinos from the atmosphere, that the neutrinos from atmosphere switch between two identities on their way to the Super Kamiokande detector in Japan. This was later confirmed by accelerated neutrino experiments like K2K, MINOS and T2K, K2K in Japan, MINOS in USA, T2K in Japan. It is still a running experiment and giving us more information. So what is the solution to the atmospheric neutrino anomaly? What does it tell us about the neutrino properties? It says that it is two generation nu mu nu tau oscillation to vacuum. Matter effect does not play role because nu mu and nu tau interact in a similar way in matter. So the vacuum oscillation probability is the vacuum probability, and this is the constant it can prove on mass and mixing. So this is the delta M square atmosphere, which is in the range 2.5 10 to the minus 3 V square. And it is, so this is, this blue region is from Minos, this black is from atmospheric, and this red is from global, including all atmospheric and reactor accelerator data. Now, one thing you can see that they don't have information on the sign of delta M square ATM, because it is coming as sine square delta M square ATM. So delta M square ATM could be greater than 0 or less than 0. And this is sine square 2 theta. So theta going to pi by 2 minus theta, they cannot say. So there is a symmetry like that, because it's sine square 2 theta. So both sides of sine square 2 theta 0.5 are allowed. So Minos was an accelerator experiment, as I said, which observed, confirmed this. And this is how they, so they were observing neutrinos of at a distance of 730 kilometers from Fermilab, and they observed this oscillation, and they confirmed the atmospheric neutrino problem and gave improved constraint on oscillation parameter. So this 1998 to 2005 was known as the golden era of neutrino physics. Results from Super Kamiokande experiment confirmed oscillation of atmospheric neutrino experiments. Results from Snow solar neutrino experiment established the presence of nu mu and nu tau in the solar nu mu flux. Result from the Camland experiment confirmed solar neutrino oscillations using reactor neutrinos. And results from K2K and Minos confirmed atmospheric neutrino oscillation using atmospheric neutrinos. And this is the 2015 Nobel Prize given to Kajita and McDonald for Super Kamiokande and Snow, and I have read the Nobel citation before. So this was the Nobel citation I read separately, but in recognizes Takaki Kajita in Japan and Arthur McDonald for their key contribution to the experiments, which demonstrated that neutrinos change identities. This metamorphosis requires that neutrinos have mass. The discovery has changed our understanding of the innermost workings of matter and can prove crucial to our view of the universe. So this is the main reason that, you know, it says that the neutrinos have mass. So the three neutrino oscillation parameters, I know, we know that there are three neutrinos. These are the three neutrino masses, which gives rise to two mass square differences. The solar mass square difference is delta M square 2-1, and atmospheric mass square difference delta M square 3-1, and three mixing angles, theta 2-3, theta 1-3, and theta 1-2. So different parameters are constrained by different experiments. And we can have this kind of ordering between the mass states, that the third state can be above the 2 and 1 states, or the third state can be below the 2 and the 1 pair. So this 2 and 1 pair is a low mass square difference, 10 to the minus 5 eV square, and 3 and 1 pair is 10 to the minus 3 eV square, which came from atmospheric neutrinos. Now from solar neutrinos, we know that there is a definite hierarchy between the 2 and 1 state. But atmospheric and accelerator neutrinos, as I said, still don't say tell us what is the sign of delta M square ATM. And the last mixing angle to be discovered was theta 1-3. It was 0 till 2011. It could be 0. But the reactor experiments observed vacuum oscillations of neutrinos from reactors through this distance, 1 kilometer. So they said that this is some other experiment than Camland, Doubleshaw, Diabe, and Renault. And there, the in Camland, the oscillation was governed by the solar parameters. But here, the oscillation is governed by the mixing angle, the third mixing angle, theta 1-3. And they measured the mixing angle, theta 1-3, with very high precision. So this is the summary of the oscillation parameters and oscillation problems, that the solar neutrino problem is due to MSW effect in solar matter. They say that the mass square is 8 into 10 to the minus 5 eV square, mixing angle close to 30 degree. Atmospheric neutrino anomaly says vacuum oscillation, see this also, it took 18 years, here it took so many years. Then delta M square 3-1 is 2 into 10 to the minus 3 eV square, because we don't know the sign, I have put mod. Then theta 2-3 is 45. Then reactor neutrino oscillation says that theta 1-3 is 9 degree. So we have two large mixing angles and one small mixing angles, and we have two mass square differences which are hierarchical. This is what we know about the neutrino parameters from all these oscillation studies. Now question is, what next? As I said, we don't know whether this three state is above this pair or below this pair. This is known as neutrino mass ordering. Also, we know the mixing angles, but when I have a three neutrino mixing angle, this is a unitary matrix, so there is one CP phase which we don't know. So this is the outstanding issues in neutrino oscillation, and many ongoing and proposed experiments are there worldwide, and maybe there will be more Nobel Prizes. I will mention just briefly about the India-MEST Neutrino Observatory, which is a detector for atmospheric neutrinos. It will use a 50 kiloton, it is planning to use magnetized iron detector, which can distinguish between neutrinos from antineutrinos, and it has a good sensitivity to mass ordering because the neutrinos and antineutrinos behave differently in matter for the two mass orderings. So they have a very good sensitivity. So INO is an atmospheric neutrino experiment for and which was planned in India. Now there is also the deep underground neutrino experiment DUNE in Fermilab. They will employ accelerator. This is also a planned experiment. Neutrinos traveling 1300 kilometers. They are aiming for groundbreaking discovering regarding properties of neutrinos, including the neutrino mass hierarchy, the neutrino CP phase. If there is, you know, anything beyond neutrino oscillation which can be probed in the accelerator experiment. So there are other experiments also in Japan and in Europe planning to take this, but these two are one of the you know, I thought the main experiments on which I am also working, so I thought I will mention. So there are other issues other than neutrino oscillation, and as I said, neutrino oscillation is measuring the mass square differences. So they don't, we are not knowing what is the absolute mass of the neutrinos. We also don't know whether neutrinos are their own antiparticle, that is whether neutrinos are Dirac or Majorana, because neutrinos are chargeless. There is a possibility that the neutrinos can be their own antiparticles, but this is also not yet known. Then we don't know, neutrino oscillation says that there are neutrino masses, but we don't know how to generate the small neutrino masses. We don't know how to explain the observed mixing angles. There are many of you working on, you know, B physics. Maybe you know in quark sector all the mixing angles are small, but in neutrino there are two large and one small. So what gives this difference? We don't know. And there is also questions that whether, you know, these small neutrino masses are related to the fact that the neutrinos are their own antiparticle. Then do neutrinos contribute to the matter-antimatter asymmetry? As we know that, you know, we exist because the matter and antimatter are not equal, because then we would have been destroyed. So there is more matter than antimatter in the universe, and whether neutrinos can be responsible for that. Are there only three flavors of neutrinos? And all these can lead us to the physics beyond the standard model. Then there are also the ultra-high energy neutrinos which are being observed by the ice cube experiment. So lot of studies are going on its origin and source. So these are, you know, the problems on which many of the scientists are involved. And answers to these questions may hold the key to understanding the nature better. So this is the thing that, you know, I think the neutrinos could be a game changer, because if we know the answers to all these queries, and it's a very active field of research, because there are also a lot of experiments which are coming up and, you know, to answer all these questions. And so we are expecting many more data and exciting times. Thank you.
So it was a very detailed and elaborate talk. So thank you so much. Sarabjit, you can ask the questions.
Thank you, ma'am. As Einstein says, never lose a holy curiosity. We are swarmed with lots of questions. So I would quickly go to the question number one. Sawant Kumar, he has raised a question. Ma'am, please elaborate the experiment of discovery of neutrons.
You know, I won't be able to tell you at this moment. Neutron was discovered by Chadwick. Yeah. Can you hear? Just one second.
Yes, now it's audible.
Yeah, just a second. Yeah, can you see my screen? Is my screen visible? Hello?
No, it's the presentation part only.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, only the presentation. Okay, because I was sharing a screen on the discovery of neutron. So anyway, you know, it was through an alpha particle bombardment on beryllium, which will give a carbon and a neutron. And so you have a conservation of, you apply the conservation of energy. And then this was by 1932 by Chadwick, and he found a neutral particle, which is the same mass of proton. So if you do the charge balance, then you will see that there should be a neutral particle. And then the mass can be estimated to be the mass of the proton. So that was the experiment when which you bombard the nitrogen atom by the beryllium nucleus by alpha particle.
Okay, so the second question is almost similar by two or three candidates, Akansha Pandey, Roshan Alshi, and Raj Panchal. Can we take sterile neutrinos as the candidate of dark matter, or are neutrinos dark matter?
Yeah. Okay, that's an interesting question. There are, you know, there are models which says that the sterile neutrinos are dark matter, but one can estimate that their mass is in the kilo electron volt range. So these are not the neutrinos which are observed by the LSND and the Mini-Boone experiment, because the not observed, which are postulated to explain the LSND and Mini-Boone results, because LSND and the Mini-Boone results require neutrinos of EV mass. So for becoming the sterile dark matter, and you know, they also observed that these neutrinos have a sizable mixing with the active flavor. So these cannot be the dark matter, because then they will wash out the structures that we observe in the universe, because they don't interact and they free stream. But the KeV neutrinos with much smaller mixing are postulated as candidates of dark matter, and they are still valid candidates of dark matter. Yes.
May I ask the next question now?
Yeah, please.
The next question is by Ashwin Kumar. How spin of a particle is experimentally verified?
How spin was experimentally verified? You know, it is, you can verify it from the conservation of angular momentum, because spin is an angular momentum. So if you apply conservation of angular momentum, then you can verify the spin of a particle.
You can verify it by neutron diffraction. If you have the magnetic cations, you can find out the magnetism by neutron.
Yes.
Okay. Another question by Akansha Pandey. What would be the energy range of hyper-K neutrino detector?
You know, hyper-K detector is a successor of Super Kamiokande. And they can observe, this is a water Cherenkov detector, so they have a slightly higher threshold. So they can observe GeV neutrinos. They also can observe MeV solar neutrinos, but they will employ different reactions for the they can observe different reactions they use different reactions for this. For the solar neutrinos, neutrino electron scattering is used, and for atmospheric neutrinos, quasi-elastic scattering of neutrinos is used, and also deep inelastic scattering. So it will depend on the so they can observe different energies. So different energies.
Okay, ma'am. Another question by Mihir Patel. Can we get data from INO project?
Yeah, when I starts, we will surely get data. But the problem is this, that there is some problem due to environmental issues. Some of you might have heard, so INO was stalled. And INO was stalled, and so it has not yet started. So we are waiting for some permissions, so for some approvals, and then if it starts, of course, we will get data from INO.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Then another question by Rajdeep Singh. How do we come to know about different neutrino flavors?
As I explained, that in the beta decay, the electron neutrino was produced. So because it is coming in association with the electron, initially we didn't know. But people suggested that, when a muon is produced, whether it is a same neutrino or a different neutrino. And then in this 1960, this experiment by Lederman Schwartz, they showed that, there is the neutrino which is coming from the muon is a different neutrino. And so then we know that there is a different neutrino flavor which is in association with muon. And then the tau neutrino was also observed. So you can postulate things, but in physics, it has to be also confirmed by the experiment. So the experiment confirmed that there are three different flavors.
Okay, ma'am. So another question by Lovepreet. Are neutrinos responsible for sunshine?
Yes, of course, because neutrinos are coming from the same reaction, the proton fusion reaction, which is giving sun heat and light. So it is the same reaction which producing the neutrinos also. Okay. So if neutrinos were not there, that reaction could not have taken place.
Gopal Chetty Brahma, he has posed a question that what type of neutrinos, according to you, comes under the category of weakly interactive massive particles, WIMPs, which could be a form of dark matter?
So as I said earlier, that neutrinos were earlier considered as dark matter. However, this is something called a warm dark matter, and these neutrinos, they create some problem in the data and the structure formation. So right now, the neutrinos that are considered dark matter are the KV sterile neutrinos.
Okay.
Not our ordinary neutrinos. Question. They are not considered as candidates of dark matter.
Okay, ma'am. So another question by Viral Srivastava, and almost similar by Vijay Maikar. Why does change of flavor occur, and why is it called oscillation? Is it because the motion of a neutrino changes the phase of associated wave, which results in flavor change?
So that, as I explained, that the reason for flavor change is because your particle in a box problem in quantum mechanics, that you have the eigenstates, but sometimes often we discuss a problem that supposing a particle in a box, it was in a certain eigenstate, and then you create a mixed state, and then you can calculate the probability that what is the probability that will be in its some number of the first ground state or the first eigenstate. So it is sort of similar, that neutrino is a mixed state. The mass eigenstates are the stationary states, and the flavor state is mixture of the stationary states. And when these neutrinos propagate, then there is a phase difference. So if the neutrino beams are coherent, then it is like an interference. So you can see, if you calculate the oscillation probability, if you can calculate the probability, you can clearly see that there is an oscillatory pattern which is given by that sine square term. So that's how, it's a basic interference phenomenon.
Bhargav Rajbanshai, ma'am, neutrinos carry information, but they even change their flavor. So information remains same, or does it change?
means see, when the neutrinos change their flavor, if we can observe that, then that will give us information on the their mass square difference and the mixing angles. So it is the intrinsic neutrino property, that you know, the neutrino mass and is the intrinsic neutrino property. But when we are observing the oscillation, we are observing the mass square difference, not the mass.
Okay. Purushottam Kumar, is in nuclear fission, are neutrinos produced or not?
In where?
In nuclear fusion reactions.
Yes, neutrinos are produced. For instance, if you neutrino protons fuse to give neutrinos, then in the reactor also you have you can have fusion. For instance, solar neutrinos they are giving you the neutrinos, right? In fusion, neutrinos are produced.
Okay. Then a question by Amrita Iyer: if mass of muon neutrino is 200 times the mass of electron, and mass of tau neutrino is 3500 times mass of electron, then when they change flavors, what compensates for this loss, a huge difference in mass?
So first of all, you know, we cannot say that the flavor neutrino has mass. Flavor neutrinos don't have mass, and this the charged, the lepton masses are not the same as neutrino masses. The neutrino, only the mass eigenstates have mass, and all we can measure is the mass square difference, which is 10 to the minus 5 eV square. One mass square difference we have measured, and the other mass square difference that we have measured is 10 to the minus 3 eV square. And you know what gives rise to this mass square difference is that, you know, we don't really have a theory. There are many models which can give you know, this kind of small masses of neutrinos. But we really don't know that which is the model or which is the theory.
Another question by Aviral Srivastava. A photon has properties similar to a neutrino, no charge, no mass, just energy. Still, we are able to detect a photon quite easily, but a neutrino can't be observed directly. Why?
Because, you know, photon is has electromagnetic interaction, right? And neutrinos are very weakly interacting. So because photons have the electromagnetic interaction, so we can detect that their strength is higher than the weak interaction strength. So they interact much more frequently than the neutrinos. So if you consider the interaction of the photon, then you will have much more interactions.
Okay. Another question by Arnab. The neutron flux from supernova burst was detected before the EM signal or EM radiation in CERN detector. Is this occurrence true? Although the detection was... Okay, first this.
No, yes, neutrinos will be detected first. So in 1987, Kamiokande and IMB detected the neutrinos first because they will be coming much quicker than the photons.
Although the detection was discarded, if even it can happen, what should we conclude? Do they move faster than light?
No, they are less interacting than light. Their interaction probability is less than light. And you know, this that is a different experiment which said that neutrinos move faster than light, and that was later taken off. And the main reason that, you know, there is nothing to relate it to the supernova 87A observation, that was because neutrinos have less probability to interact, so they can come faster. So they won't be trapped in the star, right? Because they are interacting less.
Another question he has asked is, if photons are considered, their rest mass can be attributed to the fact that they escaped out the Higgs mechanism, causing the photons massive. Now for neutrinos, they are almost rest mass less, but they do have definite masses. Is there any cosmological incident responsible for neutrinos being almost massless?
you know, in standard model, photons are massless. And photons are massless because standard model is a gauge theory. So for the symmetry of the standard model is maintained because there is a principle, you know, for which the photon has to be massless because it is a long range force, right? Electromagnetic force. If photon has a mass, then its range will be short, and then, you know, there will be all kind of interactions, stabilities will be of atoms will be not be there. So the standard model and the theory, there is a theoretical reason for which photon has to be massless. In the standard model, neutrinos are massless because in the standard model there is only left-handed neutrinos and the right-handed antineutrinos. And in the standard model, you know, the Higgs mechanism connects the left and the right states to give mass. In the standard model, we don't have right-handed neutrinos, so in the standard model, neutrinos are massless. But there is no such principle which forbids a mass, and we can construct models where neutrinos can have small mass, which is observed by the oscillation experiment. So the main motivation is the observation of oscillation experiment, which says neutrinos have mass. So one has to construct theory where neutrinos have mass.
Okay. Another questions will, I think there are a lot of questions. I'll just randomly select the few ones. Hari Prashad Ravi Kumar, he has a question that new datum from T2K gives evidence for CP violation with 3 sigma significance. Will new datum from next generation detectors like Hyper Kameo Kande produce evidence for CP violation with 5 sigma significance?
Yes, new data from T2K is giving. There is a paper in Nature recently, and before that in October they had the paper in which they said this. However, if you see, there is another experiment, NOVA, which is running, which is giving that that thing. They are also giving a, you know, CP conserving value for the best fit. So yes, the future experiments will be important for that. Now, whether they can give 5 sigma or not will depend on, you know, many factors. One has to do an analysis. What is their systematic error? And, you know, how many years they have to run? Although I have done some work in this, I exactly don't recall now whether they were going 5 sigma or not. But certainly they would go more than T2K because Hyper-K has a larger volume, and they are also planning an accelerator experiment which is called T2HK, and T2HK can give a higher sensitivity, but, you know, it will also depend on what is your value of delta CP, like for what fraction of values of delta CP it can give. So it depends on many parameters. So, you know, I don't think one can make a blanket statement until one takes into account all these things into account. That, but, you know, the hint that T2K or NOVA experiments are giving, that will certainly help in planning this experiment, that which region to probe. And this is also related to other parameters, the CP violation discovery. So it's a little complicated problem, but it can certainly give higher sensitivity than T2K, because the detector will have the flux will be higher. They have a higher flux intensity.
Ma'am, do we see phenomena like quantum entanglement between neutrinos and antineutrinos?
No, I don't know of this.
Like this spooky action over large distances.
Yeah, I think we already had enough of questions. Shrubhavati is also must be tired now by now.
No, it's fine.
Yeah.
One last question, ma'am, if you don't
mind. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. So, as you said in the possible future questions, that I've been reading about matter and antimatter a lot recently. So, and initially, if you consider after the Big Bang, there has to be an equal concentration of matter and antimatter in the universe. But now, if you look out for antimatter in the sky, you don't find any evidence of it. So now we know that neutrinos have a property of morphing from one particle species to another. So is it quite possible that neutrinos are responsible for the lack of antimatter nowadays?
So you know this is explained by a phenomenon called baryogenesis, that how the baryon asymmetry is generated. It requires certain conditions which standard is possible in standard model, but the baryon asymmetry generated in standard model is very small. It doesn't satisfy the data. So there is a suggestion that you know the neutrinos can create this by a phenomenon called leptogenesis. So the models of neutrino mass, which produce the, which you know, there are models which produce small, which give rise to small neutrino mass, which gives this mass squared, you know, small. So this is called the CISO mechanism, and in such models there can be decays of heavy neutrinos, which can generate a lepton asymmetry, and which can be converted to baryon asymmetry. So this is the field of leptogenesis, which is a very, very, you know, there are a lot of research going on in this field. So yes, leptogenesis is a viable candidate for generation of baryon asymmetry through the neutrinos.
Okay, ma'am, that was very helpful. Thanks.
And so to answer your question of quantum entanglement, I think I saw some papers, but I have not, I am not working in that area, so I didn't read much.
Yes, ma'am, it is quite possible.
I saw some papers, some recently also. Recently also some paper I saw. But you know, I have not studied those in detail. So.
Okay, ma'am. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Okay, with this, we officially close our QA session. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your resolving all the queries. As a takeaway, I would like to add, treat the sorrows of your life as neutrinos passing through your body. And keep smiling. Thank you all for your patient hearing and kind attention. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you everyone for being there. You know, it was a, there was some disturbances, so it, you know, it, the time got extended, and I'm very, very happy with all the questions that you have asked. You know, I am giving my email address in the chat box. If your question has not been answered, please feel free to send me a mail. And it may be little delayed, your answer may be little delayed, but I will try to answer.
Yeah, so I remember Shrubha from my PhD days, like when I was doing my PhD. So she was in really and a big inspiration for all the, especially women, if I say. So we all wanted to become like you, and still we are trying. So you were truly inspirational, really.
No, Harleen, you are also inspiring so many students, I can see.
No. It's not as much as you are. So we are trying to become like you, but still trying. Yeah.
I'm very, you know, it's like really such a nice comment.
I mean, when I was doing my PhD, I used to be really impressed by your personality and the way you carried everything, your career, family and all. So it was really very nice to be in touch with you. So we wanted you to come here, but unfortunately... And
yes, now the situation is such that I don't know when we can really
come. Yeah, sure. But definitely we'll be in touch and get to learn more from you.
Okay, thank you very much for arranging this, and thank you everyone. Do write to me with your questions if it is not answered or if you have any other questions.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much, Rupa.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.